got Senior and Tutu. This is Paul and George.
My friend Jay, she's gonna jump in and give you a quick lowdown on what's happening and then get you out onto the dog team.
Hello. Hello. Welcome to Dog Camp. My name's Jay. I'm going to get you guys started here. We have some very excited dogs. They're going to be pretty noisy until they get what they want, so we just have to get them moving, and they're quiet, happy, focused, doing their thing out there. We'll get you into groups, get you seated. Please get seatbelts buckled and get ready to go so we can do that. Mushers are going to make a stop on the trail for pictures. We ask you guys to stay seated, but they can take phones and cameras to the front, get some pictures for you. And once you return, you'll have a chance to get off, meet the dogs, pet them, take more pictures. They'll be calm and quiet once they're done running, so it's much easier to meet them after they run than right now when they're wild and wiggly. After the ride, we've got more for you, and then you'll get to meet the puppies at the end. We've got to save the best for last. They're kind of the grand finale of the whole tour. If we show you the puppies first, no one listens to anything else we have to say. They kind of become the whole tour, so they're going to be at the end for us. All right, so come on off, watch your step on the way out. We'll just gather over here, get you guys in those groups, and send you out with the dogs. How many do you have in your party?
I'm alone.
Okay, you can gather just right there for me.
Lead today, we got Senior and Tutu. This is Paul and George. Here we got Junior and Kristen, Mustang and Mickey, Kobuck and Yetna, Joker and Coffee, Monster and Tang. Here's Chocolate Chip in the wheel, and here's you all on the cart. And I'm Hunter.
Of course.
Ready to move?
Yeah. Let's go. Let's go.
Be secure here.
And they're off. Yeah. And now they're nice and quiet.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
They're on a mission.
Oh, yeah. So.
So they are mixed breeds, not too much shepherd in there just because they have hip displays and stuff like that to worry about.
Sure.
But these guys are calling the Alaskan Husky. So you're thinking of the Siberian Husky. That's a pure red dog. For my first try, I'm really happy with that. I can't wait to try again.
Yeah?
Oh, maybe. We're hoping to get another big deal here again.
Alright.
We're kind of at a changing of the guard moment. Alright guys, pretty much. A lot of older mushers have retired.
Okay.
And some of the younger mushers are still working on qualifying. So you do have to qualify. You gotta do 200, two 300 mile races and 150 mile races.
Thank you.
Ready? Off.
Oh, here they go.
All right, let's move.
Woo-hoo.
There we go.
A normal pee stop?
Yeah, this is a normal pee stop. That's why it's very interesting to them.
Gotta see who was here first.
Yeah.
Okay, so gotcha.
Robert was mushing earlier. He just hesitated because we only need three teams on this run. But he was parked here, so now there's like a new team smell. Especially interesting. Most of the time, it's just their smell. They check it out for a second and they're done, but now there's like new dog smell. We really gotta check out everyone's business.
Oh, yes.
Okay, ready?
Yeah, ready. All right. All right. Let's go.
All right, let's go.
Team and work our way back through the teeth. Feel free to stick with me or lag behind me, but I do like to introduce them a bit before we say hi.
So these are our lead dogs today. They're both super sweet. Senior's the red guy, and Tutu's my little girl in the blue harness here. So Tutu, she's 2 years old. She's still figuring everything out, but she's really awesome already. Senior, here's my main man here. So in any pictures of us racing, you'll see him up front. For the past 3 winters, every single race he's started and finished in lead for me. He's never come out of lead for any race miles. He's pretty extraordinary. Feel free to love on these two. I just ask you to love them up in this direction, just so they don't swing into my swing dogs. But they're both real sweet. So as we meet the dogs, I'll have you all stay on that side of the tow line. I sneak over here just so I can introduce them to you. So we call the dogs behind our leaders our swing dogs. This is George and Paul here.
George.
They both started and finished Iditarod with me this year. They're part of the Beatles. John and Ringo are gonna run later today. George has the really beautiful long black overcoat. He's very handsome, as is Paul. Paul's my littlest of the Beatles. But they like running up here in the swing. They're figuring everything out. They're really good cheerleaders. They're the ones that like to bark first, let everyone know they're ready to go. Yes, you could wish.
Oh, yeah.
So behind Paul and George, we got one of my bigger boys next to my littlest guy. This is Junior. He's a pretty big boy. He's a really honest, hard worker. I'm super excited for him to make my team this year. Piston, he's my smallest male. He's kind of interesting personality. He's always been this laid-back, chill dude. He's never been a real wild guy. And he has to run on the right side. Because if he ends up on the left, he's going to push over till he gets to the right. He's one of my right-sided dogs. Yeah, sometimes they get sided just like us. We'll end up left and right-handed. Some of our dogs are that way too. Mustang, he's a real sweetheart. He's the older brother of Paul and George. And he's running with Mickey.
Hi, Mickey.
Mickey's a sweetheart. She's got this little white mark on her head. I picked her out when she was 10 days old and that white mark on her head used to be a perfect heart. Now it's more of a triangle. Hi, Mustang, I see you too. He's a good boy. He hasn't made my team yet, but he's hoping to catch up with the younger brothers and make the team this year. He's got a real good shot. This is a father and son duo here. Kobuk here, he's the son. He's got the cool spotted legs. He's running with his papa, Yetna. Get some of that dirt off your face, huh? He's a really good yearling. He's just a year old, but he's already doing awesome on the team. Yetna's doing a great job on puppy duty today. He's one of my 8-year-olds. He didn't make the team this year, but he's one of my best dogs here on tour. Aren't you, Yetna?
Joker here. Coffee's a kind of goofy guy. He's real sweet with me because I'm his buddy, of course. But he can be shy with visitors, so we'll go over him today and give him his space. And we'll skip on to Tang and Monster. Tang and Monster are real sweet with everyone. You guys look like dogs from the back of the Kentucky Derby. So Monster, he's my hairiest. His uncle is Senior. He's kind of got a coat just like his uncle. Tang is one of my 8 years old. He got a little muddy today. That's because we let him go real quick. But Tang, he loves a butt scratch along with his face rub. He'll kind of dance around to get his booty scratched.
Okay.
But he's a really awesome dog. He likes showing off to the young guys that he's still got it.
He's still got it.
Yeah. Monster hair in our eyes today. Yeah. Monster can be slightly more timid. He's one of my winter babies. I try to have them in the summer where they end up really well socialized, but Monster and Chocolate Chip were born in February. I got Monster hair in my eyes. You got long hair, buddy. And Chocolate Chip here, he's the guy running solo. You know your name. Hi, my chipster. He's a real handsome boy.
All right, I'm trying to get some of your butt off your face, buddy.
He's had these like old man eyes ever since he was a pup. He's always kind of had these different eyes. But he's a really awesome dog. He's just still learning how to run with his partners. When I run him with a partner, he's got to switch sides and hop on their head all day long. That's why I run him on his own, but he does awesome solo.
Okay.
He had the prettiest teeth too, huh?
I wondered if there was a reason he was running solo.
Yeah. His just partners usually don't appreciate it about the fifth time he steps on their heads.
Well,
he's really tall.
I would understand.
Yeah.
You just like being on your own, don't you?
Yeah.
You want to be the boss.
Yeah. You do. Like a lion chewer. A lot of great stuff to come. She's going to teach you more about the Iditarod, show you all our winter gear. It was really nice to meet you all today. Thanks for loving on the dogs. We really appreciate it. Yeah.
Designated Iditarod and Alaska expert here. I give the presentations about our racing in the Iditarod, which is our giant 1,000-mile dog sled race across Alaska. And I'm about to tell him all about it in just a minute.
Okay. Here you go.
Too. We have 160 dogs here, so the 64 that were out for you guys is less than half of them. Wow. And every single one of them is a real working sled dog. They really race in the winter, and if they haven't been in the Iditarod yet, it's because they are being trained up to be in the Iditarod. About 30% of our dogs here are only around a year old, so this is their little summer training camp to get them used to running on a line with a team. So it's been pretty awesome getting to come here and learn so much about these dogs in the racing. I'm not going to tell you guys all about it. So, who's heard of the Iditarod? What's the Iditarod? It's a race. Yeah, it is. That's my favorite answer. That's
in
exactly what
snow.
It is. In the snow. It is a 1,000-mile race across Alaska. It's super long. Hunter, he wears his, I finished the 1,049 mile I did ride belt buckle every single day. But he should be proud of it. And I'm going to tell you guys a little bit more about why in just a minute. But dog sledding has actually been around in Alaska for thousands of years. This is where it comes from. It was one of the only ways to get across this pretty rough land for a long time. In the 1900s, as you can see from a lot of these pictures around, they were starting to get used for a couple more commercial uses, like hauling cargo. They moved lots of gold during the gold rushes, and even the United States Postal Service used them as their little delivery guys for a while. But in the 1920s, those railroads and planes finally made their way to Alaska, and they stopped using these guys for commercial use. But they definitely were still using them for personal transportation, supply runs, all the way up to the 1960s. Sled dogs was the main use of personal transportation in a lot of the rough parts of Alaska where they couldn't build roads. And in the 60s, though, there was a big change, and their practical use started to disappear. You guys want to guess what that change might have been?
Airplanes.
It's kind of close. There's actually still a lot of parts of Alaska where they can't build railroads and roads too because of the tundra, but it's the snowmobile. Oh yeah. The snowmobile came around in the 60s, and they pretty quickly realized it's a little bit easier to gas up a couple snowmobiles than it is to train up hundreds of dogs. So with their practical use disappearing, so were the sled dogs. But there was one man in his name, Mr. Joe Reddington Sr. He said, absolutely not on my watch. I'm going to let dog sledding disappear. He himself was actually from Oklahoma, but he homesteaded in Ketchikan in the 50s, and when he saw dog sledding going on out there, fell in love with it, and he did not want to see it go away. So he pitched the idea for this giant race. He's known as the father of the Iditarod. And if you're a musher, oh no, none of your mushers were Robert. He was the only guy who was parked when they all left. But he is one of our mushers here. He is Mr. Joe Reddington Sr.'s grandson. And yeah, the Reddington's big thing. Like I was telling you, some of the Reddington dogs are pretty famous dogs. Really established kennel. And Robert's brother, Ryan, he won the Iditarod this year as their first big family win since their grandfather started it in 1973. Fun fact, this guy right here, he ran the Iditarod 17 times. The last time he was 80. Oh, yeah. But it took a few years to get it going. Before this giant long-distance race, they had shorter races, usually 50 to 100 miles long with 25-mile heats. And somebody won one of those original races with a team of half Irish Setter, half Lab dogs. They had no Husky or Malamute in them at all. And that was called the Alaskan Mix. It was a mix of different Huskies and Malamutes. And they, at the time, people thought they were the best long-distance racing dogs in the world because they could handle the harsh weather. They were extremely strong. But when that happened, it kind of changed the game entirely. And they started thinking, well, what can happen if we mix our Alaskan mix with anything that's going to bring a working or athletic trait to them? And that is why all your dogs look different. Because although the Alaskan Husky is a recognized breed now, and it has been for 20 years, before that, all they were was a bunch of mutts that were the Alaskan mix that was mixed with the Lab, Shepherds, Setters, Collies, Whippets, Malinois. Any kind of working or athletic style dog was thrown in that mix. So that's why you met siblings or parents of different dogs on your teams, and they all look so different. It's like a printer running out of ink, right? It's just, but I'm just kidding. But now we're up to speed with the race. It finally got this big long one going in 1973. And it is from Anchorage to Nome. It is held on the first Saturday of March every year. This guy was pretty dang successful, making it Alaska's biggest sporting event. About 15,000 people gathered at the start line in Anchorage just to watch the mushers take off this year. Pretty big deal around here. It's on the first Saturday of March every year, which makes it pretty interesting because every year is a little bit different. Because it's being right on the edge of springtime like that, I mean, some years are going to be pretty cold still, and some years are going to be warmer, where those rivers and creeks are thawing out, making them impossible or extremely difficult to cross. The snow gets softer, meaning that the dogs are going to burn more calories running through it, and then they have to watch the calories and how much weight those dogs might be losing or gaining running through this race. But on those colder years, temperatures can range anywhere between -10 all the way up to -60. Robert said that one year, he's ran it five times, he said one year he reached -58, and he was scared to go to sleep because he was scared he'd get frostbite. So every year is a little bit different. I forgot to mention, about the Alaskan Husky also, one of the main things that sets them apart and that they achieved with them is that their recovery time is just insane. They only need about 4 hours of sleep to be excited and ready to run for another 6 hours. So these mushers, they mush about 12 hours a day in six-hour bursts. When they pull into their checkpoints, they get about 4 hours for the chores to do, but it's not really a place for them to be sleeping and hanging out because they're only allowed to stay at most of the checkpoints for 6 hours. So how much sleep do you guys think the mushers are getting a day? Not much. That's pretty close. The Iditarod, when it first started, used to take about a month to run. But like I said, we've made these dogs so amazing, it only takes 9 days to run the Iditarod now. And the mushers average 10 to 15 hours of sleep for that entire time. Robert said one of his runs was 9 days, 14 hours. And he said, but I clocked in 17 hours of sleep. He goes, but I could have done better. I could have cut it down. And I'm like, you sound crazy when you say stuff like that. But these guys are really competitive. All they wanted to do was run in this race for a pretty long time. Actually, fun fact, a lot of the dogs here, all of them are not company owned. They're all owned by their own musher. So these guys have been raised up by the people that were running them for you guys today. They're pretty close to them, and they've been raising them with this goal in mind. But I'll talk more about that in just a minute. So when they run this race, they're going to be taking this trail here. Each one of these little dots is a different checkpoint, and it has that big funny circle in the middle because they actually split it, and they run that northern route on the even years, and they run that southern route on the odd years. They split it up like that because they wanted to involve more of Alaska in the race, but it's also because a lot of these are still communities and villages of 200 or less people. For instance, Eagle Island used to only have one legal resident, so for the longest time, they called that checkpoint Daniel's Cabin. Pretty small place. So they wanted to involve more people, but they don't want to overwhelm those communities by having them host it every year. So they split it up like that. Hunter, he's one of our mushers. He might have been your musher.
Yes.
He ran in the Iditarod this year. Fun fact, Senior, I'm sure he told you, took him all the way to the end this year. It's pretty awesome. But on this southern route, Hunter told me there's a pizza place where they can get pizza ordered for them ahead of time by their supporters or family. And he said when he pulled in there, he had 4 pizzas waiting on him. I had a lady in my tour a couple weeks ago. She said, yeah, I was one of the people that sent Hunter a pizza. And I was like, oh, no, you weren't. Stop. And then she unzipped her jacket and she was wearing a Hunter Keep sweatshirt. I was like, well, maybe he did. Maybe he did. And this was Hunter's first year running. There are no Hunter Keep sweatshirts. I don't know where she got that. But probably made it, right? And then they say some mushers prefer this northern route because it has the only liquor store on the entire Iditarod Trail. That's just what I hear. That's the rumor anyway. But when they're pulling into the checkpoint, they got a few things they got to do. Every single chore they do for their dogs, they're required to do by themselves. They don't get any outside help. Just like the trail as well, they don't have any outside communication while they're on the trail. They're expected to make 1,000 miles alone. But one of the things they got to do when they pull in there is they got to change these little footies at every single checkpoint, every foot, every dog. Oh, yeah. How many of these do you think that they're going to be going through per race? Lots. That's my favorite answer. They go through about 2,000 to 3,000 of these per race. They're only designed to last about 10 hours. They are meant to be changed often. They're not made out of something thicker, though, that would last longer because these guys are engineered to be able to handle some pretty harsh weather. They don't need their feet kept warm or dry. They're just meant to keep them from getting cut on some sharp ice and rocks. If they were made out of anything thicker, it would affect the way they run. And they run best just naturally how their feet are made. And also, their main way of cooling down is by sweating through their feet. So if a bunch of moisture got trapped in a thicker, more shoe-like thing, it would freeze in there and make them really uncomfortable and affect them. But those cuts can get taken pretty seriously, and that's why they wear these to stop them from getting snagged on anything, because these dogs run over 100 miles a day. So the smallest cut that could affect their foot later gets taken pretty seriously. So they're going to be taking their booties off, and that's the time for them to check their feet and give them a little footy massages, make sure they're all okay. Then they also have to resupply, because it would just be impossible to carry all 2,000 booties with you, all that dog food, everything you need. What they're doing is they have these supply bags that they have sent out to the checkpoints ahead of time before the race ever started. They usually only have about 2 or 3 waiting on them. That's why that bag over there, it says Squetna, because that was the checkpoint. 3 of 3, because there's only 3 bags, and Keith for Hunter Keith. That was one of his bags this year. But it's pretty easy. They get those bags dropped off at their sled when they check in. And then one of the last things they got to do is they got to get everyone checked out by a vet. There's a veterinarian at every single stop. And this race is all about keeping your dogs healthy, happy. No one wants to be running these dogs into the ground or anything. This is all about keeping them safe. If they have the smallest injury, like a hurt toenail or a scratched paw or anything that could be made worse by running 100 miles, the vets or the mushers themselves will choose to drop that dog. And what that means is that after you have left your dog at the checkpoint with the vet, they wait for every musher to checkpoint through that exact same place, and then they're going to take everyone's drop dogs together and ship them to Nome to meet some designated handlers that are waiting there to take some pretty dang good care of them until their mushers meet them at the end of the race. You start out with 14 dogs. Do you guys want to guess how many you're allowed to drop down to?
10.
10? 8? 2. 2? You can drop down to 5 of these guys. Oh, yeah. Because you had 16 Alaskan Huskies pulling you guys, your 800-pound cart, and the musher on the back. And we were actually always engaging a braking system that doesn't allow them to go as fast as they would have wanted to. They are pretty powerful. So you can't replace a dog or get it back later. But once you drop down to 5, it's obviously going to get harder. But it is possible. Ryan Reddington, who won this year, he won with 6 dogs on his team.
Wow.
That guy is pretty pro, though. He's ran this race several times. He's also very competitive, and he was actually dropping dogs intentionally on different checkpoints because he wanted to cut down the time it takes to change all their booties and feed them and get them checked out by the vet. Wow. Oh, yeah, he's a really competitive guy. A pretty high-risk, high-reward strategy because if so much as 2 more of his dogs had gotten a cut on their foot, he would have been out.
Yeah.
But it worked out for him, and he ended up winning, and that was the first big family win since their grandfather started in 1973. So they're all pretty happy. The first place prize was $50,000, but they did a cost estimate of running the Iditarod when you take into account feeding your dogs all year. The entry fee alone is $4,000. It takes a few thousand to send your supply bags out, and plus the money to get your dogs there to Anchorage, because a lot of these people, they don't live there. So they said usually it costs around $30,000 to run the Iditarod.
Wow.
So what helps out is a lot of these guys get sponsors. Also, the race is heavily sponsored too. But it's a big investment for these guys. This has been a goal and a dream of theirs for a pretty long time. Excuse me. For instance, Hunter, he was 8 years old when he came to this very tour and sat right here off a cruise ship with his family, just like you guys. And he decided right then and there it was his dream to be a musher. And when he was 10 years old, he dressed up as a little musher for Halloween. Aww. And he said, nobody knew what I was. And I'm like, they wouldn't. You're from Michigan. It looked like he was just wearing his snow stuff. But it's pretty cute. When he was 18, he moved out to Alaska, started working for the Reddington Kennel. He worked for them. He still does for 4 years. And over that time, they were allowing him, because he worked his way up as such a passionate sledder, they allowed him to use a lot of their champion dogs to race his smaller qualifying races. He actually only owns 3 dogs himself. All the dogs like Senior and then that took him over the finish line were Ramey Reddington's, which is this guy's son. So, but Hunter's pretty amazing. I think all the mushers here are awesome. Jesse and him, Robert, they all raise their own dogs. And Hunter, Ramey Reddington sent him here with 53 dogs, and at least half of them are only around 1 year old, and he said, turn them into sled dogs. Like, so it's a pretty big responsibility. These guys are just insane out here. But that's why I don't race, because that would just, for me, I'm not from here. I think I need some more time to get into it and work for another handler. I work as a handler for someone like him. But that's how they get to where they are when they're not from here. They don't have a connection mushing. Is they'll start working for a kennel like that. But one of the last things I'm going to tell you about the race, and then we're going to go meet some puppies, is what happens when the mushers realize they can't finish themselves. It's not usually the weather that pushes them out. People got caught in a windstorm this year. One of the racers, he was in 4th place right here. Guess what? He was Hunter. And that's pretty awesome for a rookie runner, being 4th place towards the end of the race. But that windstorm cost him 8 hours, so he got pushed back to 11th in the end. But he didn't drop out, though. And by drop out, I mean that they each have a satellite phone, style device with them. And when they activate it, like I said earlier, no outside communications allowed. So when they activate it, they're automatically disqualified. But it means the nearest rescue team is going to come collect you and your team. And everybody gets sent to Nome to meet any of those dogs they dropped along the way. But they never want to do that. They have to run about 750 miles worth of qualifying miles of in other smaller races to even be allowed to race in the Iditarod. Because back in 1973, when this guy announced his $50,000 first place prize, you had any idiot with a bunch of dogs trying to get in on it. And there had never been a race that long before, so it got pretty risky for some dogs at times. So they decided you have to know your stuff, basically know how to get your dogs across such a great distance. No, you don't have to qualify your dog, so you can race in the Iditarod with a team no one's ever seen before, as long as you're qualified. But my point is, they just put so much work into this, qualifying, raising their dogs, giving up is the last thing they want to do. One guy, Eddie Burke, he fell off the back of his sled this year, and he decided that was not enough to make him give up. He had a bunch of faith in his dogs to get his team to safety. They did him one better. They ran 30 miles by themselves to the next checkpoint. Yes. So when that team checked in and they were like, where's the guy? And they realized he wasn't there. They sent out a snowmobile to make sure that he was okay. And they saw him walking the trail again. When they saw that going on, they said, do you need any help? And he's like, no, I don't want any help, because that would mean he was disqualified. So he decided his best bet was to flag down a passing musher. And the only musher that was willing to take the time it takes to stop the sled, put him in there, because it takes a little while to stop everybody and then get him going again, was our very own Hunter. Wow. Took him 30 miles to that next checkpoint, which ended up winning him the sportsmanship award at the end of the race. It was pretty cool. Everybody you meet on at camp, we all live here, so we were all hanging out in our kitchen the other day, and I heard Eddie Burke call Hunter, and he said, Hunter, I just did another interview about the Iditarod, and all they want to talk about is how you saved my life. I wish you'd just let me die out there. No, they're pretty good friends now. But do you guys have any questions for me before we go meet some puppies?
I do. This area right here is mountainous. I'm assuming that's why there's so many checkpoints.
Yeah. Well, it's also just because those are the only villages. Like, once you get further in here, there's just not villages in between.
Those are all villages there?
Yeah, these are different villages and okay. Small communities.
Well, I mean, that run that goes from here up here looks like pretty flat.
Yeah, so that is the difference, is that this land's flatter. So this side of the race is a tiny bit longer, but the difference is that it's just a little bit easier.
Okay.
Because, yeah, there are some rocky formations. For instance, one of the racers, Jennifer, she was one of the only of the two that had to disqualify themselves this year because over one of the rocky formations, her sled flipped over and crushed her hand.
Oh.
Yeah. So it's usually stuff like that makes them drop that agile. It's not in the weather or anything like that. But fun fact, Iditarod itself is the halfway point, and it means distant place, or in some context means clear water. But fun fact also, Shagalook, the next checkpoint, it means village of the dog people. All right, guys, any other questions for me?
How many teams usually get in?
There's not really a limit. This year was the smallest at 33 since the race started. The original had 34, but one year they had 99. So it's not really a limit. It was super cool. People ask me all the time how many women are involved in Iditarod racing. And if you look, there's going to be a poster in that next area we're going to be in. And it shows a picture of every musher who raced this year. About half of them are women. They're pretty involved. I think that's really awesome. Any other questions for me, though? What was that?
Can I change the breed of dog, or do they have the same breed?
Well, they technically don't have to be Alaskan Huskies, but Alaskan Huskies are the best out there. You're not going to win with anything else. But their main requirements are, it has to be a double-coated dog. It has to be a dog that prefers those cold temperatures. Our guys here, they do their best work. They prefer 0 to negative 20. Oh, I know it. They love that snow. They love the cold. But yeah, that's one of the main requirements, is you have to have double-coated dogs for that weather. Anything else, guys?
How many dogs were pulling us today?
16.
Okay.
So we had 4 teams out of that 64 dogs.
Okay.
And we're actually hooking up 4 new teams right now to do the afternoon tours. We don't make anyone run all day. Because this is a pretty toasty day for them. Yeah.
And did you say for the Iditarod, they do start out with 16 dogs?
They start out with 14.
14.
But there is a rumor that next year they're going to start allowing 16 teams dogs, which the mushers are pretty dang excited about. Because that means, more
so that
dogs.
That was real similar to what?
Oh, yeah, real similar.
They
oh, yeah.
That one.
Yeah, but they hook them up to a sled like this that only weighs about 300 pounds full of equipment, so yeah. All right, well, we're gonna go ahead and get up as one big group and go meet all those puppies. You can unzip your jacket a little bit and tuck them in there. Alrighty. Oh yeah, keep nice and close to you. After you get a chance to take some pictures and hang out with your puppy, we're gonna make sure we share them and pass them around. It's kind of cool, your group's a little smaller though. And then after you get enough puppy time, we have a station right next to us where you can wash your hands and grab some cocoa and coffee. But if you wanted to eat up all your time holding puppies, I understand. I'll give you guys a last cocoa warning later because it's kind of hard to take it on the bus.
Mama looks so tired.
Yeah. She's kind of over them. She wishes she was running. Oh, these guys are 28 days old. Today. Hi. Our number one rule though is they are so young, if they have any with the reassure on you, we're not gonna drop them. Don't drop the puppies. We got plenty of stuff to clean you up if they do.
Alright. Hi, baby.
That's one of our girls. She's the biggest puppy.